Hey guys, it's Emmanuel Kelly here. You're watching the Millionaire Student Show with Sashin.
Let's go back to your foundation. Let's go back to when you discovered yourself, you know, because people discovered you, and I'll go back to that in a few, but when did you realize you had a gift?
The day I realized I had a gift was the day I used music as my way, not to save myself or save my mental state in any way, shape, or form. The day I realized I had a gift was when I saw the people in the audience smile, laugh, and cry.
So the very first time that someone found you, mm-hmm. I'm not going to take too much away from your story because it's so impactful, mm-hmm. and it will definitely shift people on how real, how raw, how transparent, how emotional it is. You went through a lot of hardships. Mm-hmm. Very first time. What was life like when you were founded?
Well, so I was found in a box in a park, right? And it was, the story goes that it was two soldiers that found me, an Iranian and Iraqi. And they took me to an orphanage. And when I was in that orphanage, I was raised there for about 7-8 years. And I don't know exactly my age, but I was raised there for those years. And when I was there, I saw executions. I saw on a number of occasions, I was almost executed myself. Every day there'd be a bullet coming through there and then it hit that wall. And that day I'd know, okay, hang on a minute. And it kind of relates to business as well, because I'd have to look at that and the bullet would hit there and I would have to step back and realize, shoot, the bullet's going to be there that day. So maybe I need to play over here for the day. So it was definitely hardship. But one thing about this hardship was, as hard as it was for me, to me, it was also very normal. It was a very normal way of living. I thought the rest of the world lived like this. So I didn't really see the hardship in it. And you're from South Africa, right? So you've seen hardship, you've experienced it. You get what I'm talking about. And when you're young and you see the violence and the frustrations and the craziness that happens in South Africa, you realize that, hey, maybe as a kid, maybe this is just what the world is like. You don't realize the difference. And I think the problem in our world is we notice differences too much, and we don't notice the similarities in our world instead. We start noticing more differences. And for me, that was my hardship, but I noticed more similarities than differences, if anything.
So the very first time I got the opportunity to actually meet you was thousands of miles across the ocean. Yeah, I'm in South Africa. I'm, you know, young. I'm looking at this video and I love music, and that just led me to opening up my own music label right now, record
Incredible.
Label. But on the sideline, I'm looking at this and saying, hold on, there's a message behind this. There is, like, you don't even understand how much your story impacts the world. From a distance, I'm looking at this and saying, you know, that video that went viral on X Factor, you're going out and impacting people. So you got talent that's totally raw, but you have a story that the world needs to hear, because I believe people are too comfortable. Why are people comfortable? Why are you not comfortable?
You know, I think comfort is very subjective. That's one thing I've learned. I'm not comfortable with the way that society sees people that are, you know what, I'm not comfortable with this way society sees imperfections. To me, imperfections is what makes us perfect, right? This makes me perfect in my own way, right? This is perfect in my own way, right? You're perfect in your own way. And I think that's the problem. And I wasn't comfortable with seeing that we were so sold and so determined on creating the perfect image. And the perfect image needs to be blonde hair, blue eyes, or this person, right? It was so focused on that. And I thought, you know what? I have a gift. Yeah, I might not be perfect, but I have a gift. And I'm going to damn right use that gift and go on stage and perform. It was funny though, because a lot of people don't know, when I went on that show, X Factor, I was supposed to sing Home by Michael Bublé. 10 minutes before I went on stage, they said, "Emmanuel, you ready to sing Imagine?" I said, no, I'm singing Home by Michael Bublé. And they go, "Didn't anyone call you yesterday? We couldn't get the rights approved for Home by Michael Bublé, but we got it for Imagine." So it's amazing how things sometimes just happen, right? And it's amazing, everything happens for a reason, whether that reason is understandable or not, we may never know. But I think that things are random in our society. There's no doubt about that. But I think those random moments sometimes on a rare occasion just happened and it was meant to happen. But if I didn't sing Imagine, guaranteed you probably would never have seen
and
that
And you
video.
Never questioned that.
I never did.
No one should ever question
never.
The test that creates a testimony.
No,
you know, I always say, let things happen to you
yeah.
then rather than within you.
Yeah.
Most people let it eat them up from within. And yeah. before they know it, the biggest disease is a negative mindset.
100%.
It's nothing else. Cancer can be cured. HIV and AIDS can be cured. Diabetes can be cured. So when something happens to you, let it bounce off and just dodge the bullets because yeah. you're still alive.
Yeah.
Be thankful for that.
At the end of the day. At the end of the day, I think if you have that mindset, you know what? Whether I'm going to be successful or not, I'm alive. Have your dreams, have your belief, have your self-love, because those are really important. But as long as you have them and you see them and you look at them, and this is something that I always remembered, even when I was in Iraq, I would always have this mentality. You know what? I dream that one day I will get out of this orphanage. I hope that one day I will get out of this orphanage. And I am determined, willing, and I believe I will one day get out of this orphanage and this war zone of Iraq, right? And because I believed, because I dreamt it, because I truly, and I mean, you have to truly, you can't just say it, you have to truly, deep down within, believe it with every being of your bone. And I think because I did that, things were able to manifest. And I know that sounds kooky or wishy and wishy-washy and all that sort of stuff, but the reality is, things were able to manifest. And now I have an amazing, amazing career that I'm building and an amazing future that I'm building and an amazing movement that I'm building. And it's not just me that's building it. I'm building it with people that are surrounding me and coming around me. Yourself, you and I connected because of that. Ken, you know, people that are in our lives. And it's incredible, man. It's humbling.
80% of life is psychological.
Massively.
And,
that's
you know,
freaking awesome.
People who want the final result, they need to speak it into existence. 100%. You spoke it into existence.
Yeah.
You shifted from Iraq to Australia.
Australia.
Talk to me about that third world to first world.
Dude, it was insane. So, I mean, first of all, have you seen Argo?
No.
The movie? Okay. What about American Sniper?
Yeah, I've heard of it.
Okay. So there's these movies. They're very violent. They're very out there. But think Argo meets Jarhead or American Sniper, right? It was just the trip from Iraq to Jordan was insanely impossible. Prior to that, my brother and I almost got arrested by Interpol because they thought we were terrorists or something. It was crazy. It was ridiculous.
How old were you back? Well, how old
I was
did
about
you think?
Seven.
Okay.
Seven or eight. I'm thinking, how could a seven or eight? But you know what? It could happen, I guess, in their eyes. But that's the ridiculous part about it. So anyway, we eventually got to Jordan. We jumped on a plane. My brother, it was weird because he had a perfect Indian accent. He's not Indian, but he had a perfect Indian accent. But that was because we were raised by Indian nuns. So he had a perfect Indian accent. We're on the plane. He looks outside. We're about to arrive into Melbourne Airport in Australia. Looks outside. He goes, "Oh, it's so beautiful out there," right? At the top of the lungs, right? I'm like, "Dude, you're not Indian." But we arrive. You know, it was a massive cultural change. Huge cultural change. One, women in Iraq didn't have empowerment or strength or power or even rights. So coming to Australia and seeing women in singlets, we call it, but I think Americans call it tank tops. So singlets and tank tops. And then seeing them wearing shorts and seeing women drive. I mean, it was a huge cultural change. I went up to my grandma and I said to her, "Excuse me, who's driving this car?" And this woman goes, "I am." And then I said again, she goes, "I am." And I said it again and she goes, "I am." And then eventually she just turns around. She goes, "I am. So shut up," the top of her lungs. That's my grandmother today. Like, she goes, "Manuel, you need to remember you're new here, but women run Australia, not men." Right. So it was things like just simple things like that. I told my cousin who was wearing tank top and singlet, to put clothes on, right? So it was very unique cultural changes like that. I met my uncles who looked rough as hell, beards, tattoos, scary as hell, right? But they were the nicest people in the world. And it taught me a lesson, never judge a book by its cover, right? And then I had my surgeries and operations and different ones. And I had about 6 surgeries and operations. I learned how to walk for the first time. I learned how to use a knife and fork for the first time, eating. You know, it was the basic things that people with arms and legs kind of take for granted, right? So it's quite amazing some of those experiences that I had. I remember the first day I arrived, my mum, now I call my mum, put a plate of spaghetti in front of me. She goes, "Eat it. Good luck." She puts a spoon, a knife, and a fork, right? She goes, "Good luck." My brother and I look at each other and we're like, "How the heck do we eat this, right? This is like impossible. It's like all swirly and whatnot. We've never had spaghetti bolognese. We just had rice and that was it." And so we're trying to swirl it with a fork. It didn't work. It kept falling off. We tried to use our hands. Eventually, it took us about 2 hours to figure out how to eat it. And eventually we did. And we finished it. It took us about 2.5 hours to finish it. When we finished it, we were so messy. So messy. It was everywhere, all over us. I was 7. He was about 9. Years later, I kind of had this remembrance moment, this reminiscing moment where I looked back at that moment, and there was a powerful lesson in that. And that was, sometimes life is messy. Sometimes life is ridiculous and it's confusing and it takes you forever, whether it's a business idea or life itself or family, it takes you forever to figure out how to get through that, how to walk through that path. But when you're finished and when you've eaten that plate of spaghetti or plate of life, it's messy, but it's freaking amazingly yummy. It fills you up to the max and you feel content. You feel like you've just been given a refreshing glass of water and a plate of spaghetti bolognese when you're absolutely starving and you've never had food before.
So you were chosen. You didn't choose. Most people believe that they always get, life is a multiple choice question where they're going to choose the right answer all the time, and it's going to be such a perfect ending and a perfect path. You don't even know your age right now. You don't even care about your age. Your age could change every single day.
Exactly.
And that is a typical example of how people should perceive their mind, of how old they are, not what their identification says or what, you know, was written down. So going back to when you got your first name, going back to when you found out your age, who gave it to you? How did you receive it? How did you feel? And what did you, from that moment onwards, execute towards?
It's hard to know what I necessarily felt, because I would have to really dig deep and try and remember. But I do know this. The minute I arrived at the orphanage, I was given a name by the name, my name was given to me, and it was Ali. That was the name that was given. And I think it means light or something like that in Aramaic and Arabic. But Ali was the name that I was given. And then on Christmas Day, about a year later or a year and a half later, my name got changed from Ali to Emmanuel. Now, what's massive about that name is, you said something, I was chosen. And I think when you just take a step back and you just appreciate life and just live life and just do the one thing that you need to really remember to do, and that's survive. Just survive. Don't hurt anyone while surviving, but just as long as inside of you, you know that you just want to survive. But it's not going to cost someone else. You're not going to hurt someone in order to survive, because that's wrong. But if you just learn in yourself, I'm worrying about me. In this moment, I'm learning to just love who I am and appreciate it. And since I was a kid, I've always just enjoyed life for what it was. I was immune to the violence and immune to to the dangers and the craziness. And so I think in my eyes and in my mind and in my heart, deep down inside, I felt, you know what? It doesn't matter whether I live or die today, as long as I enjoy my day in some way, shape, or form.
There's a few words that actually that pop up whilst we're having this conversation. You know, I see you have this little badge that has love on it. Yeah. You have grit. Yeah. You have hope. Those are three words that most people aren't taught.
No. But it can be taught.
Yes, it can be taught. And you've developed it through your environment. But you never let your environment affect you. You've affected your environment. 100%. So let's go deeper into mentorship. Because it's so easy. Your video blew up organically. now you're in a path where the world knows your name, the world knows your story, there's no hiding anymore. And how did you find mentorship? How did you find the right type of mentors? How did you realign that?
It took a while. After the show, a lot of people don't realize, but I went through a very up and down battle. I got into drugs, I got into alcohol. I thought I was God's gift to earth. I thought that I was the, you know, the savior, right? I got cocky and arrogant but I also got a lot of bullying, social media bullying, death threats, people calling up my own family, threatening their lives. I mean, it was pretty vicious. A lot of people don't realize that, hey, you know, oh, he's just tough and he's got the, you know, he's so strong, but there's strength in sometimes having weakness. Sometimes being weak is actually stronger than just being fully strong. And so I went to a very weak place. And I'm glad I went into that weak place, because if I didn't, then I don't know where I'd be right now. I don't know if I would be a hypocrite or what it was. But I went into a very dark stage. I toured and I went to, you know, 40 different countries at 17, 18 years old. And I was touring and I was performing in front of 20, 30, 40,000 people at each concert. And I was a star. I was just, they saw me as a god. And it, deep down inside, I wasn't ready for that kind of responsibility or more so acceptability of what was put on my shoulders. And so I think I went onto this dark path trying to get away from that, but also trying to escape the memories that I had in Iraq. Because of all this, it was launching my brain into having these crazy memories. And so I went through this dark path. I went broke. I lost all my money. I spent it on stupid things. I had the wrong types of people around me. And it's only been in the last probably year and a half, where I've started to go back on the path that I was put on this earth for. And it had to take time. I needed to go off path in order to get back on path, if that makes sense. And I suffered, but. It was something that it taught me those qualities that you gave me. It didn't teach me, it reminded me of those qualities. There was a soldier when I was in Iraq. He came up to me. Soldiers came up to Iraq and pointed a gun at my brother and my head. And they said that they were pointing it and we're ready to die and everything was going to happen. And we were gone. You know, it was the gone period of our journey. And I thought I was done. Right? But something inside of me, I don't know what it was, but something inside of me made me bite this soldier really hard on the leg. And I bit him. I just crunched down on it. And the soldier screamed, put the gun up in the air. And a soldier in front of him that was higher up than him, higher ranked, comes up to me, looks at that soldier, looks at me, and he goes, then looks at that soldier as though he's disappointed in the soldier, and looks at me and he goes, he's got balls, and walks away and just goes, shh. Within 30 seconds, every soldier was out of that place. Prior to that bite, they were going to shoot everyone in that place. So I had balls as a kid, whether I was born with it or not. I think everyone's born with determination, will, and balls. It's how they're activated. And this moment had activated it, right? And so it had activated it. And so years later, though, what had happened to me was I'd lost those balls because of the people that were around me that I chose. It was me that chose them. They didn't choose to be around me. I chose to have them in my life. Had somehow found a way to deteriorate my confidence and willpower and almost control what I'm trying to do with my life. And that took me into a very dark place. And when I stood up and owned my power again and owned my strength and said, you know what? This is who I am and I love who I am. I am the guy with one arm. I am the guy with three fingers on the other hand. And I am the guy with a damn good looking face, right? And most of all, I am a guy that has a gift and I'm going to use this gift to not for me to inspire myself or motivate me or escape from the horrors, but actually to motivate people, to inspire people, to lift them up, to tell them it's okay. And most of all, you are not alone.
You stood up to that very moment with the soldiers.
Yeah.
You stood up. Most people aren't willing to stand up to their problems. So I look at your life. You're living almost your fourth life right now.
Yeah.
Very first life, yeah. Iraq. Yeah. Second life, Australia. Yeah. Third life,
Hollywood,
you
baby.
You know, Hollywood. So you're living your third life.
Yeah.
You've learned from your mistakes. But most people, when they look at, you know, entrepreneurship, they do it for the wrong reasons. Most people look at being an artist, being an athlete, being an actor, an actress, they look at it for the wrong reason. They're either chasing the fame mm-hmm. or the fortune.
100%.
I believe if people had the right vision, mm-hmm. the right goal, mm-hmm. this country, this continent, this world
massively.
Would be a better place.
But it also, it will attract, going back to your statement with mentors, right? It will attract the mentors that you need in your life. So I always say my mom's my hero and my brother's my inspiration, right? My brother is an Olympian. He's at the World Championships right now, but he's an Olympian, right? My mother is a humanitarian. She's my hero. But my brother is my mentor and inspiration, right? In so many ways. He was my minder in the Middle East and in Iraq. And there was one day where I got to save him. And that was that day with the soldiers, right? But you know what? Every other day he saves me. He protected me. He guided me. He was my first ever mentor. My second mentor was when I came out to Australia, who I called my dad. He unfortunately died last year, but he was mum's biggest supporter. But he was a mentor to guide me through life, to teach me about the basics, to teach me that I'm going to go through sad and frustrating times. And everything he said came to fruition. I'm going to go through a weak period of my life. I'm going to go downhill. But that is going to teach me the lesson to reignite my spirit and my bones and my confidence. And then my third mentor became my musical mentor. And that's Chris Martin from Coldplay. And so it's just amazing how each mentor celebrated my journey. My brother from Iraq and those stories, this man, Pat, kind of my life in Australia taught me that it's okay to be me, taught me to focus on learning how to walk and all those things. And then my third, the musical guy, the guy who taught me that it's okay to dig deep with music. It's okay to focus on the artistry. And most of all, remember when you're doing it, don't do it because you're doing it for fame or you're doing it for glory. Do it because you want to create something special for others. Do it because you want to motivate others. And most of all, do it because it's your talent. So don't ever hide the gift that was given to you by the universe, by God, by whatever you want to believe in. Don't ever hide that. Use it. And you don't have to be the best at it, but at least use it. And there's ways. Be creative. Be unique. Find a way to make money. I mean, you did it. Look at you. You're a great example, bro. So, you know, I'm becoming an example, but you're a great example. I'm inspired by you.
Thank you.
You're welcome, man.
I believe.
I mean, I'm better looking than you, so we'll just remember that. But
I believe that there was no coincidence in you and I meeting. You know, right. I'm sitting there. A call comes in. I watched the video years ago. And I'm like, I need this guy. Yeah, I need that. 6 years ago, I'm 19. I just get involved in entrepreneurship. I'm barely making $1,000 a month. I need this guy on my show. not based on having you on the show, but based on your impact off the listeners, off the viewers. Millions of people will watch this. Whilst I have access to you, I know you're performing to, you know, with Coldplay next week.
Yeah.
I know you're performing with Snoop Dogg next week. You're going to be performing on the Millionaire Student Show.
100%, let's do it.
Let's pick your favorite chorus, favorite song.
You want me to sing a song?
Please.
How about it's one of my own songs?
Why not?
Song's called Never Alone. I wrote it when I was a kid. I was 11 years old. I wrote this song. It's about a loss of a brother that Mum brought out to Australia. But what's powerful about this song is it's about never being alone. It's about remembering that there are other people that have suffered. And it's about remembering to always dream big and to fight and believe in yourself, into God, and whatever you want to believe in, but most of all in love. Love for yourself and love for others. So a song's called Never Alone. Goes like this. Open my eyes and know you're in front of me. Open my mind and know you're with me. And through my life and know you're beside me. I will never be alone. And through the storm and know you hold me. I felt the hand of love, it touched me. And in everything you do, you change my world. I will never be alone. Oh, 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 oh. I will never be alone. Oh, 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 oh. I will never be. You gotta sing it now. Be alone. Oh, 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 oh. I will never be alone.
Incredible, man. Thank you so much for
being
on the Millionaire Student Show.
Thank you
for adding not just wisdom, not just, you know, your story, but most importantly, pain can be turned into purpose.
100%.
Purpose can turn into passion. Passion can develop and create a story that the world will know. I appreciate you for being here and impacting people. And just thank you for being you.
Thank you, bro. I appreciate you. Thank you for having me on as well. And to everyone that's watching this as well, I just want to give you one message. Love yourself. Embrace who you are. Don't be afraid. And stand up to your own demons.